In this video, I'm going to share with you some quick updates on my affordable filament recycling project. You'll see a few steps forward, a few steps back, and you'll learn a few valuable lessons that, unfortunately, I've had to learn the hard way. Let's get after it. So before we get into the updates, I will start by saying that this video is going to be a little bit different than the others in this series. At the end of the last video, I said that I wanted the next video, this one, to be all about testing, both on the shredding and on the extrusion sides of filament recycling. And unfortunately, this video isn't that. I've run up against some major setbacks, as you're about to see, and because I'm going to be visiting family abroad for a couple of weeks, I wanted to share some relatively quick updates for those of you who are eagerly following along. At first, I really wasn't sure just how interested all of you would be in me documenting all my screw-ups, but you actually made it very clear that you're interested in seeing where things went wrong so that you can hopefully learn from them. So sit back, relax, and prepare to learn how not to build a filament recycling setup. As soon as I hit publish on the last video, I received a message from our resident mad scientist and savior, Daniel, who gave me a piece of very bad news. I would need to rebuild the entire shredder. As it turns out, I did everything right except for one crucial detail. I'd put all the knives on backwards. So instead of actually pushing the material into the fixed knives and shredding it, it would have just pushed it up. Son of... It wasn't fun, but I spent the better part of an entire day trying to rebuild the shredder without completely disassembling it, only to realize that it was in fact much easier to just take the entire thing apart and rebuild it. I then spent the better part of another day getting it aligned so that it spun smoothly, not realizing at the time that the bearings provided with the kit are actually self-aligning, meaning that I wasted a ton of time on multiple occasions aligning bearings that just would align themselves. God. With all that done, all I had to do was wait patiently for the CNC'd parts to arrive so that I could start putting it all together. Now, because I'd made a lot of mistakes in measurement already along the way, I really didn't want to mess around and try to calculate where I should drill the holes or weld the mounting points until I actually had things assembled and in their final positions in my hands. In short, I lost about a week of work just due to waiting for the parts. Fortunately, the parts did arrive and they looked, felt, and fit perfect. In fact, now is probably a good time to mention that the only part of this project that has actually gone well has been ordering the CNC parts from this video's sponsor, which, as you probably guessed, is PCBWay. The parts arrived exactly as I designed them, and they even took the time to pre-oil the coupler, which needed it, but clean the oil off the flange, which didn't. Now, I was a little bit worried that I didn't select the extra tolerance option at checkout because I wanted to see just how precise their standard tolerance option would be, but wow. The parts literally fit together exactly as I would have hoped, without any play, but also without too much friction so that I'd be able to remove them every time I needed to fix something, which, as you're going to see, is gonna happen a lot. In short, I'm super happy with my order from PCBWay. Like I said, it's probably the only part of this project that has gone without a hitch so far. So whether you need PCBs, CNC machining, metal 3D printing, injection molding, laser cutting, a whole bunch of other stuff, honestly anything, just make sure to check them out using the link in the description or visit jle.vi/PCBWay to get $5 off your first order. Anyways, with these CNC parts now on hand, I went about putting things together, but of course I didn't have the right hardware on hand to actually mount it to the frame. Now, I knew I should wait, I knew it, but after months of working on this project, I was really impatient and I just wanted to see it in action. So I decided to just turn it on for 1 second just to test that the motion was working. This ultimately led to one of the most triumphant moments of my adult life, followed immediately by one of the worst. The motor kicked into gear, turning everything as expected. But you probably know what happened next. Heck, even I knew that it was probably going to happen. The sheer power of the motor turned the entire shredder, which lifted off the frame. I'd honestly thought that I'd either be able to hold it down or catch it or cut the power in time, but fun fact, did you know that a VFD doesn't cut power immediately? Yeah, I didn't know that part. So basically, the motor fell on the ground, bending the shroud and shattering the cooling fan. Fortunately, repairing the motor wasn't that big of a deal. Another fun fact here, I literally had never thought about the origin of the phrase hammering it out until this moment. as I was hammering out the dents in the fan cowl. I also had to drill out a bunch of the fan shroud screws because they snapped clean in half when the motor fell on them. By the way, I will have to apologize here for the lack of B-roll showing a lot of this stuff, especially when we get to the much bigger oopsies later on in the video, because honestly, I just was not in the mood to record footage as I was putting out fires and grumbling through fixing all my screw-ups. Anyways, with the shroud somewhat back in shape, I cracked open on shape and I designed my own version of the cooling fan, which I printed in ABS to prototype and then polycarbonate for the final version. Honestly, I just wish that all of my screw-ups throughout this process were as easy to fix as that one was. With that repaired, I headed to my local hardware store the very next day to buy a bunch of hardware so that I could start mounting everything onto the frame. I also went about measuring where I would need the mounting holes and then adding more steel extrusions at all the different points where I actually needed the frame to be thicker. I actually had run out of steel bars in the last video, but fortunately I squeezed in one more trip to the free hardware store on my street before they demolished the building, and I picked up a motherload of steel bars. Side note here, I was so focused on applying everything that you all have taught me about welding during this process that I actually didn't think to clamp the bars together properly. So instead of putting something flat on the top and the bottom to ensure that they were level with the existing frame, I clamped them like this, and it turns out that they were thus at a slight angle. So I had to spend an hour or more grinding the new mounting bars flat, which weakens them significantly. Lesson learned. I also learned that it is not a good idea to try to lift a precarious 50 kilo shredder and motor setup onto the frame by yourself, because I then managed to drop it once again, this time onto myself. But both of those lessons pale in comparison to the lesson I was about to learn. You see, with this new layout, the gearbox is a little bit lower than the input for the shredder. Now I knew this, and I also knew that I needed things to be exact, so I planned to take something that I knew would be flat and level, unlike my welding work. I took a piece of coated plywood used for cabinets, and I cut out a hole for the shredder. Then, to get things exact, I lined up the shredder with my eyeball, and then pushed different sizes of washers under the mounting holes until everything looked level and even. Then, given my experience with the whole thing flying away on me before, I bolted everything down extra tight onto the frame. I didn't realize it at the time, but this would turn out to be the nail in the coffin. But before I discovered that, I did have a few brief moments of victory. The shredder worked. It actually shredded plastic. Yes! The VFD controlled the speed, and I was able to shred about a kilo of plastic. You guys, I was in a state of absolute bliss. The only thing was the knives kept getting stuck on thick pieces, and the motor was heating up like a lot. Also, there seemed to be a little bit of rocking with the shredder kind of dancing back and forth. Plus, the plastic on one side of the shredder seemed to be melting. What the heck? Look, I'm going to spare you guys the gory details of diagnosing the issue, not only because I really don't want to talk about it, but also because I was once again in no mood to record B-roll footage. I'm sorry. Let's just say I spent the next 3 entire days doing everything I could to figure out what the heck the problem was. Was it the coupler? The gearbox? Did I fail to grind everything completely level on the frame? I took everything apart. I even took the whole shredder apart twice, just to see if maybe I had mounted the bearings wrong. Again, not realizing that they are self-aligning to protect from exactly this type of thing. In the process of disassembling it, I had to cut all of my welds that honestly were much stronger than any of us could have predicted. But of course, Murphy's Law, only on the parts that I would later have to disassemble. Irony at its finest. Ultimately, I threw in the towel and I begged my new BFF Daniel to take the train down from Haifa to come help me diagnose this issue. In exchange for burgers and filament, Daniel spent the evening teaching me various tricks such as how to measure concentricity with a dial gauge and diagnosing the issues with me. I'm not going to beat around the bush here. We figured out the issue, and it's that my shaft is bent. Giggity. How could that be, you ask? I mean, it was straight when I installed it, and like me, you probably would assume that there is no way a 72 kilo weakling like me could bend 20 millimeters of mild steel. Could it be when I dropped the entire thing? No, that actually doesn't make sense. Well, after taking out the entire drive shaft for the I don't even know how manyth time, Daniel and I looked at the nature and location of the bend after where the grub screw was, and it all became clear. When I'd shimmed the shredder, I had spent a while testing different heights, not sure whether the space between the wood and the bottom of the shredder was 3 millimeters or 3.5 millimeters. And because there was a little bit of play as I was lifting it up by hand, trying to find the perfect height, it was really difficult to figure out what that was. So I had bolted it down at 3 millimeters and then later decided to add another 0.5 millimeter spacer to shim it up higher. And that ultimately sealed my fate. You see, while I alone am nowhere near strong or heavy enough to bend the drive shaft, if you attach that drive shaft to 4 large bolts and then tighten them, it's basically the opposite of a car jack. So I had literally bent the drive shaft down using the bolts by approximately that 0.5 millimeter when I test fit it the first time. 0.5 millimeter doesn't sound like much, but it's a big deal when you're dealing with these types of forces. And that is where the friction is coming from. That's why the whole thing rocks, why the motor doesn't have enough power left over after lifting the shredder to shred thicker pieces of plastic. That's why it's overheating and why there's enough friction inside the shredder to melt some of the plastic. Daniel and I spent 30 minutes or so trying to somehow bend the shaft back into place, but ultimately we both agreed that we were just gonna do much more harm than good. And that the only way out of this is either by going to a professional machine shop to fix it or by ordering a new drive shaft entirely. Yeah, I'm pretty devastated. With that said, it's not all bad, and I do want to leave you on a high note. So let me tell you a little bit about the experiences I've had so far with extruding my own filament. After the last video, my power supply came in and I got to work finishing the art mate. Now, there were a bunch of things that I'd done wrong in the assembly, like wires that needed to be crossed and so on, but fortunately, it was all easy enough to fix. To test things out, I actually hand pelletized a bunch of filament with a flat cutter, and I was super excited to see my first extrusion ever come out. It was at that point that I decided to order all the parts for Teaching Tech's open source pelletizer, because I think that it'll be really, really useful to be able to pelletize last meters of filament rolls as a means of adding some uniformity and consistency to my otherwise random regrind. Now, I haven't gotten around to building that yet. Once I'd gotten the shredder fully tested, I did try extruding some of the raw regrind just to see what would happen. ArtMay specifically recommends using only dry 4 to 4.5 millimeter or smaller granules, which is about half the size of the ones currently coming out of the precious plastic shredder with its 8 millimeter sieve. But here, once again, curiosity and frankly impatience got the best of me. To my surprise, the early results were actually pretty promising. I was able to extrude some filament, but as you might expect, it was pretty much impossible to get a consistent 1.75 millimeters diameter. I did try running my regrind through the shredder a second time, but it really didn't make all that much of a difference. I then tried 3D printing a hand sieve and hand sifting my regrind to only isolate the smaller granules, which I put into my cheapo toaster oven for a few hours just to test out drying. To my surprise, they did not melt so long as I kept the door cracked, so that actually might end up being a very good drying solution in the long run. Oh, and also, while I'm sharing positive updates, I did make one cool hopper upgrade while the shredder was out of commission. Now, in my early testing, I noticed that the shreds tend to fly everywhere throughout the shop, and it is super dangerous and messy, so as I'd kind of assumed before, a hinged lid is going to be necessary. But instead of wood, I took a suggestion from one of my YouTube members and actually made it out of clear acrylic, which I think will be really cool to let me watch and also film the shredding as it happens. All right, let's talk next steps. Most importantly, I need to either get the drive shaft fixed or order a new one altogether. Now, I was going to try and get that done, but then, as you maybe hear from the sirens, our government and the Ayatollahs decided to see who has bigger rockets. And now my kids are home from daycare, so that will probably not be able to happen this week. Regardless, once I figure that out, I am going to play around with extruding those 4 to 4.5 millimeter dried granules just to ensure that they are a good size. If so, I'm going to have to hand drill my own custom sieve for the shredder to replace that 8 millimeter one, which I've already removed. And that's probably going to mean finding a new free hardware store for the sheet metal. Now, just a reminder, it's going to be a little while before I'm able to share any updates about this project, because assuming World War III doesn't break out, I am going to be visiting family in the States for the next 2 weeks. But don't worry, because I am planning on taking my Positron V3 on vacation with me, and I will do my best to continue creating high-quality content for all of you while I'm on the road. So there you have it, a quick, at least for a next layer video, update on where my filament recycling project stands. And hopefully you all have taken some very valuable lessons for your projects, especially if you want to try and recreate this project at home without all the speed bumps. It has been far from smooth sailing, but I do want to let you guys know that your comments, your encouragement, and just your interest in this project are really what's keeping me going. So thank you all so much for that. Let me also take a moment to thank our YouTube members and Patreon supporters, particularly our Nylon and Peak members, Chip Cox, Two Crazy Ketos, Amir Chen, and Chris Miller. You guys rock. That's all for this week, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.